Baruch Hashem, first time I'm here in this beautiful shul. And before we start the lecture, there's one request. There's a list. Please, everyone, write his information, name, telephone number, email. Bezrat Hashem, maybe we should do something weekly here, like routine lectures. And obviously more and more people will come, and next time more friends, until the place will be packed completely. Baruch Hashem. Tonight, we're going to speak about shiduchim, matchmaking, soulmates. This kind of lecture can only be successful if you have a lot of questions for me. Now, if you think you don't have questions for me, think again, because I get questions about it thousands every month from people before their marriages. Obviously, I have many, many questions about how to find a soulmate. And once you find, you're not sure if it is. How do you know this? How do you know that? The parents, work, Torah, learning, sicknesses, problem, history. So many questions. Actually, one of the most important decisions that a person makes in his lifetime, who is he going to marry? The next 20, 30, 40 years of his life, he's going to be happy or sad or half enough based on a 1 week decision or sometimes 1 day decision. He decides, that's it. Many people think, of course, finding my soulmate is obviously a critical decision, and it's going to affect the rest of my life. But how many people really know that it's going to affect their eternity, not only this life? It's like 40, 50 years, it's a blink of the eye, like Chazal say. Ha'olam hazeh ke'eref ayin. This world is like a blink of an eye. Oh, it's over, 70 years, it's gone. It looks very long, morning, evening, morning, Shabbat, and again, it looks very long. But when it's over, you look back, it was very, very short. That's if we live full life. Some people don't even make it to that, 70 or 80. So life is very short. Whether it's 20, whether it's 80, it's still very short compared to eternity. But eternity is much more important than 40, 50 years. Now, when I say eternity, what's the connection between who is going to be your wife or husband to what's going to happen in 1,000 years from now to your soul? What's the connection, no? Over here, you understand. If she knows how to make good ashpolo, or she doesn't know, it's going to affect you every evening, you know? You come home and the food is not good. You want to go back to your mother to eat. If she knows how to cook, you gain weight every night. Sometimes I see a person, a month later I see him double on his size. Like yesterday, I gave a lecture somewhere. Person that I just saw a month ago already became double. Sometimes it's the other way around. You see a person very heavy, the next month, half of what he was. Why? He got a call from the IRS, poor guy. He can't eat anymore. You know? So, what happened is, yes, you know, you're raising the children. I have news for you. Most of the people in the world, their marriage is roommates. That's what it is. Nothing more than that. Husband, wife, going to places together, raising children. It's basically roommates. Why? No love, no attraction, no respect, no man, no woman, nothing. Just two roommates. Accidentally, it's a man and a woman. Could have been two men, two women. Raising children, that's it. Two babysitters. One supply with money. The other one is a babysitter and a cook. And that's what most of the houses are in the world, unfortunately. The question is this what God wanted for us? Two roommates raising children? That was the intention of making a marriage? Of course not. It's much more into it. If we read all the books about relationship between men and women and what is the way it's supposed to be compared to what it is today, it's like Chinese and Hebrew. That's what it's like. There's really almost no similarity whatsoever. Not that everyone is like that. Some people, it's not like that by them. But how many? 5%, 10%, 1%? Not that many. Today, we have an epidemic of divorce. Two generations ago, even secular Jews did not get divorced. That was very, very rare. Very rare, 80 years ago. Your grandparents, most of them were religious, but even the ones who were not, they can tell you that when they were in the 20s, if one person was a divorced person, everybody in the country knew about it. Kids couldn't say the word divorce 40, 50, 60 years ago. It was a bad word, like a curse. Yeah. Today, it's almost rare to be married. And happily married? It's like finding a red diamond somewhere. How many years will it take you to search for it? It's very, very rare. Something is happening to society. People with yarmulkes, with beards, with black hats, rabbit hands, women. Something is not working in a system. It's an epidemic. Same thing, cancer, it's an epidemic. 50, 60 years ago, a case here, a case there, everyone was crying. Today, every 5 minutes, a new case. Every 5 minutes. Every 5 minutes, another case, and another name, and another name. You get dizzy. Just the amount of Tehillim you have to read for so many victims of this horrible epidemic, you cannot leave the Tehillim 1 second of your life if you really have to fulfill all the emails you get. So the question is, would I be one of the statistic? That's it, because that's the way it is and there's nothing we can do. So if we have to suffer, we suffer. Maybe I'll be the finally lucky one that will do things right. And my marriage won't look like most people. It will be a major success. Is it possible? Or maybe already there's no chance. What do you think? Who think that the marriage institution is a successful institution? Raise his hand. Anyone here thinks it's healthy, the marriage situation in a Jewish world? In a non-Jewish world, I'm not even talking about. There's nothing to talk about. In the secular world, there's also nothing to talk about. When you look at the 70% divorce rate, how can you even ask the question if it's successful or it went bankrupt or not? There's nothing to even talk about. I'm talking in the ultra-Orthodox world, not Reform, not Conservative, none of these things. All these institutions, all these groups already went bankrupt long time ago. I'm talking now the world of the religious people, those who are formed from birth, and those who are Baalei Tshuva. Do you think that the situation in this world is good? Who thinks it's good? Please raise his hand. Baruch Hashem, there's many people here. Not one person thinks it's good. So I'm not exaggerating. Who thinks that the marriage institution in this world went bankrupt? Raise his hand. Many hands. Okay, so you're realistic. Unfortunately, that's the situation. Who can raise his hand and tell me what's the number one reason why the marriage institution today, it's not what it used to be 50 years ago? What changed? I heard. It's a good answer. But I have news for you. The situation was critical before they invented Facebook. How many use Facebook in business? Seven? Believe me, 15 years ago I already had these issues. So yeah, it obviously made the situation a lot worse. Maybe you should say internet, if any, because that's already like 20 years old or more. Who thinks he knows what's the reason, the main reason why it's not being successful? What's happening?
High expectations.
people always have high expectations. It's nothing that this generation has that we didn't have 1,000 years ago. No, give me more answers. Yes. Yes. You have to understand, don't give me general answers that I can answer back to you that this already existed 50 years ago. These things existed 50 years ago. Give me something that happened now, in the last 20 years. Yes.
Reputation.
Like, it's hard to hear.
Self-centered. People are more self-centered.
Ah, egoistical. Okay.
We decided and we agreed in last. We all changed. But most of the women changed.
All I can tell you, you're lucky there is a separation between you and them. You know? You see, if you've been in Egypt, a shoe would fly from there to your head. Baruch Hashem, you in New York.
Assimilation.
I'll tell you how we can analyze this issue. When we find that a group of people have a sickness more than other group. Statistic, you know, statistic don't lie. They give you 80%, 50%, 20%, 10%, none. Then you know there's a difference. If you go to an area that you see that 80% of the people over there are overweight, and then you go to a place that 80% of the people is below the average weight, you have to find, to put your finger on the main cause, what's causing the people here to look A and what's causing the people here to look B. When you come to groups of people in the Orthodox world, Baalei Tshuva, Sfaradim, Ashkenazim, Persian, Bukharians, Americans, in New York, in LA, in Israel, you find some differences between one group to another. You find in certain groups the same problems, materialism, almost everywhere. People are very, very addicted to materialism. So that's everywhere. That's here, that's in Israel, that's in LA, that's everywhere you go, Europe, same problem. So that's one common problem. But sometimes you find something that you have here but you don't have over there. Let's give an example. From all the groups of people in the Orthodox world, who has less divorce rate than all the groups? The smallest. Hasidim. Now, you have to ask yourself a question. What does the Hasidim do that make their divorce rate lower than the other Orthodox Jews everywhere else? What's difference about them? Who think you can tell me two or three things that makes them different than all the others?
They don't have any other person to compare to. What would they set up with? That's it.
Very good. I will basically repeat what he says soon. And
divorce isn't acceptable. Like, it is.
Good. So, two good reasons so far. Who else? That's what he said. Yeah. Follow the Torah more? No. There are other Orthodox Jews who follow the Torah just as much or more. So that's really not it. What? Yeah.
When they're dating, they're looking more for like certain values.
Partially correct. Yeah. Good.
First of all, there's not materialism, and second of all, there's also a vocabulary of a set of life.
Materialism exists by them also. Did you ever visit at Borough Park recently?
Because their parents made a decision.
But also, because first of all, they both have the same life.
Okay, let's go one by one. All the things you say, almost all of you are correct. First thing is what was said here before is you don't have what to compare it to. Let me explain what he meant. When you take a Baal Tshuva, which means a person who was born and raised in a non-religious environment and he has a non-Jewish values and everything was free, He met girls in school, elementary school, high school, college. People did whatever they want. I don't want to be too rude, but almost like animals, or sometimes worse than animals. So eventually, at one point in his life, he realized his life is a mistake, so he made tshuva. He made repentance and became an Orthodox Jew. When he's going to get married, his chances to get divorced now is much, much, much lower than before. The statistics don't lie. And the situation in the world of the Baalei Tshuva, it's still much, much better than the secular world. That means there is an improvement. But from all the groups of Orthodox Jews, the Baalei Tshuva has the highest divorce rate. From all the people that are considered Orthodox Jews, the people who made repentance has the highest divorce rate. They're still much, much better than the Goyim or the secular Jews out there that have nothing to do with religion. Still much better percentage. But compared to all the other groups, they have the highest divorce rate. Why is it? Because it's very, very difficult to erase your history, just like it doesn't exist. And what is it like? A person that never saw what a car is in an island somewhere. And one day, a car fell from a plane. A car with a parachute, oh, it fell, and he came, he saw a key, he played with the car, the car started to go, and he drives the car, and everyone else riding donkeys and horses. And he has a car, drives around, and all the Indians there in the island, they all bow down to him, because he has a car. Even though his car doesn't worth $50 here in America, in a junkyard, they beg, who's going to take it away and save us the towing? But he is a king of the island, right? He doesn't know what to compare this car to. Because that's the best, by him, it's the best, and the most ideal that he can have. So as long as he doesn't know any better, he's very happy, very satisfied. Every second he uses this car, he's very, very happy. What would happen if a beautiful, brand new 2013 Mercedes or whatever, I don't know, a good car, is falling into the island next to his car. And now his friend has it. And he compares his, in Israel we have a name for it, it's called Susita. One time Israel tried to make a car, and they saw after 1 year that all the cars disappearing. Why? The camels used to eat it. It was made from fiberglass. So the camels love fiberglass for whatever reason. They come, they begin to eat the car. So if you park in Be'er Sheva, the Arab comes there, he parks his camel, he goes to the market, he leaves his camel over here. You come, you see only a wheel, no car. They decided it was also very noisy, horrible car. So, you know, Israel is good with technology, but with cars they didn't do so good. So what happened? Once you found the car that is a million times better than yours, the human nature already doesn't let you enjoy the car you had and enjoy it so much. Why? Because now you're comparing it to something else. In a different words, that's what he say over their Facebook. If you got the point. They don't have it. They are close. They live in a close environment. Most of them, not all of them, some of them are breaking the fence. And those are the ones who get divorced, because they all have divorce. But most of them don't know anything about the world. Most of them don't learn English. The women learn, but most of the men don't know English. They don't know how to go to these websites. They don't see what the average Baal Tshuva saw. And when they go on a one-time date, 45 minutes, right away they're very satisfied with what they get. Because for them it's the ideal, the best. And there's nothing to compare it to. And right away, they get a great connection, and they get married, and most of the time, they'll be happily married for the rest of their life. However, if it's a Baal Tshuva that became Hasidic, it's not going to be the same. Because he already have another 3, 4, 5, 10, 20 things to compare it to. He's always going to have things in his mind that will never make him happy. Why? That's the human nature. So comes the Torah. The Torah say, do it in the right way, you enjoy it forever. Do it in the wrong way, you're going to pay the price. There's no surprises. That's one thing that was brought up. Second thing. Society does not permit divorce so easy. Today in the rest of the world, when you come and you say to your friends, I'm getting divorced, why, what happened? 5-10 minutes. And then they say, okay, Yishar Koach, we'll help you. We'll try to help you out. People accept you. You're not worried that your children will be kicked out of school. You're not worried that your children, people would point to them in a school and say, poor kids, their parent got divorced. Those days are over. Today, almost everyone is divorced. So, you know, it's one of thousands. Nobody is afraid. No one is afraid. There's nothing to lose. Right away, he think, tomorrow I'll find something much better and I restart my life. I have a lecture in my website, in case you didn't know. It's called Divorce. Why would I make a lecture about divorce? Because there's so many people who get divorced thinking they're going to find something much better. In reality, they don't find anything. There are three different categories in life. There is happily married, and that's a very small category, as we said. There is bitterly married, very, very bitter. And there is singles. All singles are bitter. So there's no two single. Happily single, bitterly single. Because all single have only one thing in their mind. When will I finally get married? I'm talking Orthodox people. People who make sins, they're not in a rush to get married. The opposite, they try to stretch the sin as much as they can before they commit. Why? That's the way animals are in the field. The chimpanzee have 5 wives. Why should he have one? And he doesn't need to buy her a drink and make a show. He doesn't have to give her ketubah. Doesn't have to worry. Doesn't have to cheer her up when she's depressed. They do whatever they want, the animals. But some of them are more faithful than people. If you follow nature, you see something very interesting. So now I want to ask you a question. Which one is worse? Bitterly single or bitterly married? What do you think? If you ask the single people, they say nothing can be worse than being single. I'm 30 years old already, 10 years, I'm dying to get married, it doesn't work out, I'm exhausted already from that. That's the way they think. What happened to them if they finally get married and now it's horrible, it didn't work out? Then they missed the days that they were bitterly single. So what's worse? The problem is that when you're married to a person that you don't love or you don't like also, it's like living with a roommate that is your enemy. I don't have to tell you how horrible it is when you walk into the apartment and you have a person sitting in the living room when he's ready to kill you, and you hoping every day in Shmona Esrei that he will disappear one day. So it's very difficult, you know, to live like that. You have only one dream. When will I get rid of this roommate? Right? So life is full of stress. Since most of the marriages are roommates, unfortunately, as I said before, and I'm speaking from, unfortunately, I wish it wasn't true, from lots of experience. Many years of experience, every hour, 18 years. It's a lot of experience of what's happening in all different groups. So most of the marriages are basically roommates, because no one knows his obligations in marriage from day one. People got married, they entered the deal not knowing their obligation. Let me give you an example. If you hire a manager, the manager must know his obligations in a business, no? If he doesn't know his obligations, can he do a good job? If a man entered the marriage, he met a girl, they go on a date, everything looked beautiful, they love each other, everything is nice. But then, he doesn't know the role of a man in a Jewish marriage. He doesn't know. Can he be successful doing his job? Obviously, there's no chance. Same thing the woman. If she doesn't know her role, how is she going to be successful? The problem today, that's one of the things that were mentioned here before, that when people enter the marriage, everyone thinks, what am I going to get and to gain from this relationship? When the Torah said the other way around, you have to understand, what am I going to give to this relationship? You know the difference? You come to the world to give, or you come to the world to receive, is completely a different approach. When you are a worker of someone, you're not complaining that you do the job, because you know that's what you were hired for. But if they told you you're going to be the boss and they made you the servant in the end, you're killing yourself, because you came with the intention to be the boss. And now they're giving you orders. But if you already came knowing I'm coming to serve someone, this is my job and I'm happy to get hired, that's a complete different mentality here. Most people are egoistical, they're selfish, they don't learn Musar, they don't learn ethics, they don't learn Torah. Their children raised them in a very bad way. They didn't get a good example from their parents in this generation. And now they come into the marriage, and on top of all the problems, they don't even learn one day what marriage is about. Do you know one of your friends who got married that can come and raise their hand and they say 6 months before their marriage they are learning every day what they have to do in their marriage? How many men or women can raise their hand today in the Orthodox world, thank you, and say that they know what is my job as a man? Let me give you examples what I mean. When a man gets married to a woman, he signs a document, an agreement, which is called ketubah. What does he commit to in a ketubah? Do you know? What is he committing to? Just to give her food and clothes to wear and a place to live? That's only a part of his obligation. What's the other part of his obligation? Relations. Intimate relation. Which means, if his wife waiting for him tonight to come home as her husband, and he say to her, I'm going with my friends to a baseball game, it's equal to a person who just went to a restaurant and ate a big pork steak with his friends. Same thing. Now you ask him, come eat pork. Say, you crazy? I'm a Baal Tshuva. I'll die, I won't eat pork. Say, no, no, come, we'll give you $1,000. Eat pork. No, no, no. $5,000. No. $20,000. No. $100,000. Eat pork. No. But to leave his wife once a week to go with his friend play backgammon or cards every week. So, where is the obligation that he signed on? The problem is that it's an obligation from the Torah. That is an obligation from the Torah. Women have their obligations. Why women created in first place in a creation? Why there are women in the world? The Torah say, Vayar Hashem, and Hashem saw, Ki lo tov eyot ha'adam levado. It's not good for a man to be lonely alone. Eseh lo ezer kenegdo. I'll make him a partner, a companion, an assistant. So I'm gonna make him a soulmate. Well, and he made him the woman. Now, do you trust the creator of the world that he made the partner of man in the best way possible? Or you think he messed up maybe a little bit? There is some defects in it. Maybe he didn't know. He could have done it better. There was a way to make it better. Sometimes people say to me, I wish Hashem would have done this and this and that in the world. I wish this wouldn't be like this. I wish. So I always answer them one answer and it always works. I say, everything you say, it's only good for people. The engineer made the car like that. There was ways to make it better, because people are not perfect. But by Hashem, it doesn't apply, this comment. You cannot say, I wish Hashem would make it better. There is no better. You ask me, what do you mean? A kid is dying in a hospital from cancer. It couldn't be better? Of course it could be better. It wouldn't be cancer, it would be better. Well, what's the question? What are you selling us stories? So the answer is, I still insist that it couldn't be better. It couldn't be better. Why? If you know Hashem, if you learn about Hashem, you know that Hashem does everything, not 99.9% perfect, 100% perfect, always, forever. Just that we are very limited and we don't see how to tie things together and we don't see the connection, we don't know reincarnations, we don't know what does it mean, reward and punishments, we don't understand the concept of a soul, of the afterlife, of body and soul, of materialism, of temporary truth, of eternal truth. There's so many things to know. We don't know all the systems. We cannot put them together. What are we even opening our mouths to make comments? We don't know. I don't know engineering. Can I come to the company who make F-16 and F-15 and make comments about the F-16 that came out? Oh, why did you make it like this? Should have made it like that. So the engineer said to me, for 80 years we in research. $5 billion we invested until we came that this is the best conclusion. And you came now after 2 minutes of looking at the plane and you give us comments? Put him in a mental house. That's where he belongs. So a person asks, why this baby was born blind? Where is the justice? Why? It's not fair. Why this baby is enjoying and he cannot see colors? It's not fair. It's defect in a creation. God forbid. So what would be the answer to this? A 30-second video. 30-second video will change every comment you ever made. Hashem say, oh yeah? No justice? Okay, hold on. Hold. Pause. Shut the light. Press play. You see this baby? He said, let me show you who this baby was 10 years ago. You see now a video, and you see this baby had eyes. He was a man. And what did he do with his eyes? 70 years killing people. Shooting, murdering, raping, stealing. He used his eyes only for sins. And now Hashem sent them back blind. That's his punishment. It's an easy punishment? Of course it's easy. Could have been a million times worse. It's with a mercy. So he's only blind. That's his punishment after he killed so many people. If you see now a baby in Iraq that have horrible life, poverty, living on the street, get molested, have nothing in his life, running from one place to another, you feel very bad. So, wow, look at this baby, how much he suffer. Then Hashem say, oh yeah, hold on. He play a video, you see this baby, Saddam Hussein. That's who he was 10 years ago. So, Hashem, it's not fair. You're too easy on this baby. Give him more. 5 minutes ago, he said, it's not fair. Why is he suffering? It's just only one detail you didn't know. That's all. It changed everything. You have to understand one thing. Marriage is a big decision. It's not a partnership in a pizza shop. Worst comes to worst, you lost $100,000. No, Hashem take, Hashem give. Money comes and goes all the time. You're getting stuck for eternity. Who can raise his hand and answer me, what do you mean eternity? I understand I'm going to suffer for the next 10 years until I get divorced. Or for the next 30 years if I don't want to get divorced. But why you keep saying eternity? What's the connection between who I'm going to be in my next life and the one after? Or in heaven or in hell, God forbid. What is the connection from the choice I'm going to make today? Who can understand what I'm talking about? Yes.
They didn't say a physical body. Your body, that's what the person knows that he needs to die. They know that he won't die. His body, his soul is on. That's a soul made.
What you say, it's true, but it's not answering my question. I maybe didn't make my question clear. I say Reuven has two choices today. They're offering him Sarah and they're offering him Rachel. If he chooses Sarah, it will affect his eternity in one way. If he chooses Rachel, it would affect his eternity in a different way. Same thing by the ladies. She's going to choose Yosef, that's going to be her end. She's going to choose Yitzchak, it's going to be a different end. But not only here, for eternity, in billions of years, is going to affect her soul forever and ever and ever. Do you understand the question now? How can I prove that it's going to affect everything for eternity? Yeah.
The choices that your partner promotes or enables or helps you to make. So if you have a Rachel that's amazing, that tells you to go learn, to go to lectures, to build yourself, or you have a Leah that tells you, no, go to poker, go to basketball, it's two different afterlives you're building for yourself.
Very good, but that's only in this life. Why eternity? Okay, so Rachel made you a big rabbi, you go to heaven, that's it. In the end, Hashem said, good choice. You chose this girl and not that girl, thanks to that you're going to heaven. If you choose her, you would go with her together, I don't want to say where. But since you chose her, this is your end. Very happy end. But why eternity?
Your choices now affect your eternity.
How?
How?
How? That's it. One day a person died, his wife died, and they're over. Okay, the soul got to a specific level in heaven, and it's over. What is the marriage has to do with what I'm going to do in heaven or somewhere else? No, so? Actually, it's the other way around. It was one neshama before the marriage that united together. It's two halves. But I'm not talking now mystical Kabbalah. I'm talking now two individuals, man and a woman, got married. It's going to affect each other's eternity. Yes? Very good. Finally. Baruch Hashem. You see, let me explain to you something. You marry a girl and she sends you, like you say, to yeshiva and you become a big rabbi and you're a holy man and you learn Torah and you're serious. Not one of the fake ones, a real one. And you learn and you give your life for the public and you do a lot of great things and your children are influenced by you. One good example is Rav Ovadia Yosef. His son said, in my own ears I heard, our father didn't have a minute time for us. Only in a cleaning for Pesach, he did a favor to my mother. He used to take us with him to buy, when he used to buy Arbat Aminim before Sukkot, so he used to take the kids with him that she can clean the house. Because it wasn't like today, 15 rooms. You can put them to play in one room and clean all the others. It was one big room, that's it. There was the houses in those days in Yerushalayim. So the only way to help the wife, for someone who only knows how to learn Torah, is to take the children with him. So that's it. And once in a while, he had time. He took one kid with him. He walks with him. He spoke to him. But that was just about it. How all his children became big rabbis, one by one. The biggest rabbis now, everywhere. They saw a good example. It influenced the house. They saw how our father is real, not fake. He's not only learning when he gets paid from the yeshiva. He learns all the time. In the lunchtime, before the yeshiva starts, when the yeshiva is off, when it's Shabbat, when it's Yom Tov, when it's 1 o'clock at night, all the time. In a plane, in a car, in the street. So they got it. You don't know any other. You grew up in such an atmosphere, obviously it gave you a huge advantage than someone who grew up in a kibbutz. It's a big difference. So now these kids, these sons of him, that each one became a big rabbi today, have their own kids. And they see how their fathers love to learn. So now it's affecting his grandchildren. And then after 120 years, when he's going to be in heaven, his fourth, fifth, 10 generations, it's going to affect each one of them. And he's going to benefit from each one of his descendants based on the choice that he made 150 years ago. He continued to benefit forever, ever and ever. However, if he took a wife, like you said before, just take me to the mall, let's go to the sushi, let's go to the pizza, let's go to Miami, let's go to Pesach over here, let's buy a boat. Religious. You know, the skirts barely touch the knee once in 3 months. That's a celebration. His wife's skirt finally reached the knee. So he opened a champagne. L'chaim, what's the occasion, my dear husband? Baruch Hashem, after 3 months, I cried to Hashem, your knee, your skirt finally reached the knee. Orthodox, from Bess Yaakov. $100,000 jewelry, 15 perfume from the duty free all over her, $5,000 wig, walk in the street, Vini, Tony, everyone is impressed, clapping. And then they die one day, and Hashem say to him, look at your children. One guy, his blorit touching the ceiling of the shul, cannot walk through the door, maybe he break the mashkofir. One guy like this, one guy like this. And he said, it's not my fault, it's your fault. Why you give me such kids? That's what happened. What do you think people say? Very rarely you see a parent that take responsibility. Mr. X, why your son is not so religious? It's my fault. Why? Why it's your fault? You're an Orthodox Jew. I wasn't good enough. So he learned to be half enough. Now when a person learns half good, half bad, what do you think the evil inclination will convince him to do? To go to the good half or to the bad half? The bad half. There's even inclination, desires. We are always searching for the negative more than we search for the positive, as long as we don't get caught. The idea is like this. Let's really talk about now, someone is offering you a shidduch. Let's talk about the Ten Commandments of finding your soulmate. First rule, now it's going to be recorded. Please listen to it at least three times before you go on your next date. Because I believe that everyone is single, so it's really going to help you to make your choice. First thing is, never to say no to someone that offering you a shidduch because of the nationality of the person. Which means, you grew up in a Bukharian family, or Persian, or Ashkenazi, whatever you are. Your parents don't want someone not from their own group. They want someone with the same culture like them. So when they're offering you someone with a different culture, right away they're threatening you. No, say no. We don't allow it. What are we going to eat? Gefilte fish? Forget about it. Right? That's not an indication for a healthy marriage, how good the fish or the ashpolo will be. It's only good, excuse me, not to hurt anyone, by people have no brain. By them, it's an important thing. Someone with a brain, he care about the food, he care about the clothes, he care about the accent. This is nonsense. He care, righteous person or not, loyal or not, decent or not. That's what's important. Learning Torah or learning in a casino how to play blackjack. Who cares about his accent? Yiddish accent, not Yiddish, Israeli accent, Russian accent. So nonsense. People focusing on what's not important so much. And the most important three, four things, nothing. They'll pay the price in a year. So never to say, I don't want this kind. I don't want that kind. No. First you go and you see. You may be very surprised. Many people who never believe they marry Ashkenazi, they are happily married today. Or the other way around, Sfaradi, very happy. I have one Hasid, he married an Argentinian woman from Syria, Syrian Argentinian. And he said, the best choice I ever made in my life, he said. And you know, it was very rare by him to marry somebody not Hasidish. Even a different Ashkenazi is rare, not to talk about Sfaradi. But he did that, he was brave enough. He's the happiest person, you should see how happy he is from his marriage, bli ayinara. So you don't know, it can be very, very good. Second thing, if you go on a date, and you are not attracted at all to the person you're dating, look-wise, physically only, forget about spirituality for a minute, physically, you know, forget it, there's no way I can connect with this kind of look, of physical, too short, too tall, too heavy, too skinny, whatever, everyone with his, what he prefers. Don't ever listen to people, even if they have beautiful beard and they know the whole Torah by heart, that tell you, don't worry, one day you'll fall in love. Because sometimes it does happen, but 90% of the time in this generation, it will never happen. It will only get worse. Because in the beginning, there's some kind of excitement. After that, the excitement disappeared and the situation become a lot worse. So a little bit to compromise, it's okay. Because nothing in life is 100% perfect. But to go with a girl or with a guy that you're completely not connected, there's no, you don't feel that it's going to be a healthy relationship, a man and a woman relationship, and you say, no, he's a very big tzaddik. He learns Torah all day. Yeah, he's a very big tzaddik. He's a very big tzaddik to be a rabbi of the shul. But it's not for you as a husband, because you don't feel any connection or attraction to him. The Torah wants men and women to live in harmony. A part of marriage is physical relationship. And whoever thinks that it's not, is a Christian. It's not a Jew. A normal Jew that knows Torah should never tell a man or a woman, marry, even though you're not attracted to the woman. Or marry him, even though you don't like how he look. It's very, very foolish. We are not talking roommates here. Or two rabbis who wants to open a yeshiva. So big deal, they don't like how each other's look. Who care? When you open yeshiva, you only want a tzaddik and talmid chacham. Because you're not going to get married. When you marry the woman, she must be pretty in your eyes. Not pretty to the world, pretty in your eyes. Even if everyone doesn't think she is, but you think, that's good. As long as he likes her, as long as she likes him, that's it. So, remember, it's very important. No, who can tell me what's the third rule in the Ten Commandments of the matchmaking? What's the third rule? After you saw that this girl or this guy, it's your taste, you know, yeah, there can be a connection. How long, if you see there is a little attraction, you're not sure yet, it could go completely positive or it can turn completely negative. You need at least 3 dates to know, 3 dates. Sometimes in a first date you have mixed feelings. You like the look but not the same, it's mixed, yes and no. I like this but I don't like this. But after 3 times, some of the things that bother you in the first and second date stop bothering you. And the connection becomes very strong. Or the other way around. What wasn't such a big deal in the first and second date, all of a sudden begin to bother you very much. So minimum 3 dates to know. Sometimes you know after one look. Oh, no, please, not for me. Understand right away. Don't waste time. Why to hurt a person? To make him go on a date, pay money, whatever, and then there's no even 1% chance that it will happen. So after, physically, you like each other. What comes after? After you saw the person, even before you dated him, it's much better first to see who it is, at least 1 second, and then to say if you want to go on a date. But before you agree to go on a date, you have to make all the necessary investigations about this person. Not first to go out 2 months, and then begin to investigate his history and his record and his drug usage. No, it's already by now too late. I remember one time, my wife and I, we set a couple, from birth. The guy is Litvish, Ashkenazi. The girl, Litvish, Ashkenazi. One from Brooklyn, one from Muncie. So we brought the guy to us, to Muncie, that he will meet the parents of the girl. But the parents will come for 5 minutes to see who the guy we're about to set with their daughter. Accidentally, there was a misunderstanding. They came with a girl. There was a misunderstanding in the times, so they came with a girl. So they saw each other before they started the investigation. And that's against the regulations by from people. You should see what the week I had after. The father of the guy was destroying me from morning to night, calling me, screaming at me. Horrible week ahead. I was even in LA 15 minutes before Shabbat, or, you know, in 15 minutes before Shabbat in New York. I'm in LA. I say, you have 15 minutes before Shabbat in New York. You're still complaining why your son saw the girl. I say, yeah, because by now it doesn't pay for me to do any checking. Because he already liked the girl. What am I going to do? Break his heart? You understand how it works by people who never saw anything in their life? Only Torah and modesty. That's it. One look, it's over. Because he knew he's coming to meet a girl. And that's the first and the last girl this guy will see in his life. And Baruch Hashem, very happily married today. It worked out good, but it was a mistake. So just to show you how delicate it can get. So after that, when you like him, you don't say, okay, let's go and meet while we're dating. No. Big mistake. You have to know everything about him before. Where he learned, what yeshivot, who was his mashgiach, where is he holding in the last 2 years. Don't have to know 10 years ago that he ran away from class. Fine, it's not going to affect your marriage today. But you want to know, at least in the last 2 years, what's with him? Serious, he learned, he walks, whatever you're looking for. You have to see if this is existing right now. The family, brothers, sisters, manners, what's his friend saying about him. But don't only check with the references that they give you. Go and check people that you find on your own. Sometimes the references are bribed. What does it mean, bribe? They like them. They like the family. They don't. Their heart doesn't let them say something bad. They know nothing is perfect there. But it's our neighbors. Well, we're going to say something bad. Not everyone is a Talmid Chacham that knows that if you know something negative about something in a Shiduch, that it's critical, you must say it. And it's not Lashon Hara. It's a kosher Lashon Hara. The Torah say, you must save another Jew from falling in a trap. So if you know, God forbid, that this person has anger management, he can't manage his life, he's very angry, every little thing, scream, violent, breaking things. And when he's not angry, he's very, very sweet. Sweet, nice, flower, open the door for her. But wait until she gets him angry for the first time, what's going to be? So when are you going to tell her? When she's going to be in a hospital? No, now. You have to say, nice guy, learning, good, this, family. But one problem, what is it? Very, very angry person. Now she want to marry him, it's her choice. At least, you didn't tell her wonderful, and she asked you about his personality, you said, perfect, good, great guy. And then she get married, and her life is destroyed, and Hashem will punish you for all her suffering. Because you didn't say the truth. In Shiduchim, even if it's your brother, you must say the truth. They ask you, hey, tell me your brother, is he good like you? Is he learning like you? No, he's not. He doesn't learn at all. It's only pretending. But it's your brother. What's the difference? Your brother or another Jew? You're going to bury someone? You're looking for someone who learn? I don't think, you don't have to say my brother is a loser. You can say my brother is not such a serious learner. And they get the point. The only one you're not allowed to talk about Lashon Hara is your parents. But you can hint. You can say, well, ask somebody else. You know, it's my father. I can't talk. They ask you, tell me, we want to go into a partnership with your father. Is he an honest businessman? How can you ask me such a question about my father? What do you expect me to say, Lashon Hara, about my father? Ask someone else. If he's clever, he won't have to ask anyone. Because another kid would say, my father, the most honest person. Doesn't know how to lie even. Okay. But if he didn't tell you that, he didn't say Lashon Hara. He told you, go ask the rabbi in the shul. I got the point. I don't even need that. I call someone's house. I see how his wife and children answer the phone. I know exactly what's happening in this house. By the way they talk. When you ask to speak to him. You feel in the voice. If they're angry at him, disappointed, they love him, they admire him. You feel right away. If you see someone and you speak to him about his father, his body language, if you know body language, turn right away everything about this man. How his son behaves when he talks about his parents. You know if they're good, they're generous, they're not, they're violent, they abuse him, etc. You see it right away. Even if you say nice thing about them, sometimes the body tells the other way. The other way. And you can see. Not everyone knows how to read it, but it's okay. So I have to check. Now, what happened if a person had drug history, but today is clean? Clean. That's a very, very hard question. It first depends what kind of drugs, light drugs or heavy drugs. But even before we even comparing between one drug to another, reality shows that at least half of the people who stopped with the drugs eventually returns to it. You ask my opinion, my personal opinion, I would never agree that my children will marry someone that had a history, even though now it's clean. Who knows what's going to happen in the next depression. And this week I had a case like this of a girl who married a guy, is into drugs for 3 years already. Horrible life, police, problem, arrest, lots of problems. And she say, no, I still hope that things will get better. What's going to get better? 3 years didn't get better, it's only getting worse. You don't want this kind of life. Why? Even if a person is a very good person, once he's under drugs and alcohol, it's not him. It's a monster that lives in him. It's not him. You can see he's the nicest guy in the world when he's not in drugs. But what's going to happen in an hour? He's going to kill his own mother for the drugs. Doesn't feel. It's not him. It's an addiction. Now, some addictions we can still live with. Like we have addictions to food. No, we live with that. It's not the end of the world. There's all kinds of addictions. But addictions to drugs or to alcohol or to gambling, it's not an addiction you can live with. So if they tell you this guy is a gambler, stay away from him. This guy likes to drink, stay away from him. This guy sometimes takes drugs, sometimes stay away from him. You marry him, it's your end. 9 times out of 10 times, it will end very bad. Gambling, it's not only goes to the casino. Gambling is online. Gambling is in a stock market. All the times, options, buying, going crazy, losing all the money. Before you realize, you find out you have $1 million debt. Every week I find cases like this. That the wife have no idea what's their situation. She drives a beautiful car, lives in a nice mansion. In reality, her husband already owes millions to the mafia. Any minute, the Italian mafia will knock on her door. She doesn't know what's happening. Now we, the rabbis, have to save her now. And her children from who knows what. You got to be very careful. So you have to check. You ask with the neighbor, you ask with classmates, roommates in this, in a university, in school, in yeshiva, the rabbis. You get the truth. You get the truth. You have to get the truth. When are you going to find the truth? After you're married already with children? It's going to be by then too late. Now, there's many other problems that are also can ruin the marriage. For instance, laziness. Laziness, it's also an addiction. It cannot get up in the morning. Moshe, get up. What time is it? 9 already. He had to be at work. Forget about going to shul to pray. Last time he was in shul, it was in his bar mitzvah. 2 minutes, he gets up quickly, puts tefillin, Shema Yisrael, Shmona Yisrael, with his slippers, with his pajama. On the way to the subway, he brushes his teeth. And somebody like this, sometimes women come to me and say, what am I going to do? My husband, 11 o'clock, I cannot get him up. Problem, every job he has, he gets fired after a month or two. So I ask, when you dated, it was also like this? She say, yes. How did you get married? I don't understand. How did she get married? She fell in love with him. Why? She didn't follow the Ten Commandments of Shiduchim. If she would check about him before they going out on a date, it wouldn't happen to her. Once it happened, you know how difficult it is to fight against love when it's a desire and love between. You know what parents do to break between their kids to somebody bad that they're going on a date? They're willing to kill their parents as long as they're not going to take their love away. There's nobody. You beg them. You show them proofs. You show that they're cheating. You show things that they do. You show their cell phone. Whatever you show, nothing convinced them. They're going to marry them anyway. Why? Desire. Desire. Like drugs, same thing. The idea is not to get addicted already. Once you're addicted, there's no way to, no return. Later, they'll find out after they one day will wake up. Most important thing, if a girl wants a Talmid Chacham, somebody who learns Torah, but he doesn't have such a good personality, pride, ego, sometimes anger, disrespect people, speak Lashon Hara all the time, but loves to learn and full of Torah, give beautiful speeches all the time, make good impression, even nice looking, whatever, charismatic, but doesn't have such a good character. Or a guy that is not such a great in learning. He learns. When they come to yeshiva, nobody really hold him as the highlight of this yeshiva. You know, he's an ordinary learner, nothing special. But great personality, kind, helping, never speak bad against anyone, respecting, not egoistic, very good. Nice, good heart person. Which one is better? Big Talmid Chacham, not such a great personality. Not a big Talmid Chacham, learning, but you know, nothing special, but great personality. Which one is much better for Shiduch? The Talmid Chacham or the other one? Who thinks the one who knows a lot of Torah? Baruch Hashem, all of you are smart. But you know, oh, you think that Torah is more important than personality? Yeah? No, okay. I just thought I saw you moving your hand. So you're right. Midot comes before Torah. Why the purpose that Hashem gave us Torah? To correct our midot. So if the midot is not good, what's the point of knowing Torah if it doesn't make you a better human being? You understand? Now one more thing. Cigarettes. Cigarettes. You want to ask my opinion? If I would be a woman, I would never step a step next to a person who smokes cigarettes. Not that it's like drugs or alcohol that can make you kill someone. But every second of his life, he's torturing people. Everywhere you go. Everywhere you go with him, he smoke here, he smoke. People breathing it, people suffering from it. He goes out, smoking a terrace, go in, out, this, that. It's not comfortable. If you're a smoker also, no. Two smokers, they don't suffer. But when one smokes and the other one is not, it's a problem. Smoking, if someone considers start smoking, should know it's a horrible, horrible habit. Not to talk about that you're going to lose a lot of money. It's very expensive over the years. Everyone around you suffer. You are addicted. It's controlling your life. And everyone who started smoking regretted. Everyone. Eventually, everyone regret. Why starting? Why? It's relaxing me. Read a little bit Torah, listen to a good song, it will also relax you. I have to pay $10 a pack to get relaxed. Song is for free. Listen to a good lecture. Well, Pirkei Avot, you get relaxed. What's the point? You need chemicals to make you relax? Something is not right here. One more thing. Many of the people have mental issues that it's hard to detect. Some people are crazy, literally crazy, taking medication, but you can detect it right away. But many, many people have on and off attacks. 2-3 months, they're perfect. Boom, 1 week attack, they need to be hospitalized. They didn't take their medication, chemical imbalance, and this. Now, what are you doing in this case? You still have the right, if you want to marry a person that is always depressed, always have schizophrenic, all kinds of things. Like, it's your choice. You want to do it, fine. It's very difficult to maintain a house like this. But you have to check very, very carefully today because a large portion of society have mental issues. And many of them are detected only a few months after the marriage, and by then it's too late. Either you're pregnant already, or you already bought a house, or you know how. What, 2 months after I get married, I get divorced. You know how many people, for instance, they finding out that their husband has a bipolar only a few months after the wedding? Now, what's the problem with bipolar? Hashem will give a remedy to every one of those. The problem is that I know a guy like this. He didn't take his medication because it makes him very slow. And he drove with a car in Manhattan, Queens, I don't know where, and started to hit people and car, and the police all over him, and he mamash hit people, cars in the street, going in red light, 100 miles an hour in street with kids on the street. You want a husband like this? It's not his fault, poor guy. It's not his fault. There's nothing he can do, but he can control it. It's a very big issue. Or people that have schizophrenia. It's two different people. Today is nice, tzaddik, everything, learning. Oh, the next day, tomorrow, it can be a murderer. Go and kill someone, and he comes back, and he's a different person. He doesn't even know that yesterday he killed someone. Like years. Two different people. Or he talks with himself. And it comes on and off, depending how stressed he is in life. Bottom line, there's a lot of mental issues. Chas v'shalom, it's not... I'm not speaking against anyone that have mental issues, but at least the other person has the choice to know what he's getting. And sometimes people know that you're about to marry him and they don't tell you. And they are guilty for every suffering you're going to have for the rest of your life. So you gotta be very, very careful before you get married, just because the guy looks great and he's very smart and he works with the Gemara all day. Many people have mental issues. I'll give you an example. I know a few Orthodox people that all they do is Torah and Mitzvot, but they mentally yield. For instance, when they come to say Kriyat Shema, they do 10 times. maybe one word they did not pronounce correctly. Say again and again and again. They go to the mikveh, they go, they're about to get dressed, and now I didn't do it good. They go again. They're compulsive. That's a very serious disease. It's going to make your life a nightmare. But he does only mitzvot. But it's not normal. 100%. Now let's talk about mental disease that nobody thinks is a mental disease. Except Hashem. Hashem knows it's a mental disease. Such as stinginess. Stingy. Can't give a dollar to his wife all day. Where did you go? What did you buy? Why these shoes? Why not this one? Why? But it's $5 cheaper. Why I didn't wait? Next week there's a coupon. You want to marry someone like that? Do you know what a nightmare your life is going to be? A person knock on the door, he gave him $2. What? You give tzedakah without my permission? Why you bought meat? Why you give the guest meat? They can have chicken. You're laughing. There are thousands of people out there with beautiful beard and hats. That's what they are. That's what they are. You gotta know very carefully who you married. Girls, what's the most important thing to check by a girl before you agree to marry her? Before you agree to date her first time. What is it? Two things. Modesty and Shabbat. Why those two things? Because a woman who keeps modesty perfect and Shabbat, she already have 90% of what Hashem expects from her. Everything else is 10%. Blessing, this, kosher, chesed, whatever she does, it's very important. Candles, whatever. Modesty and Shabbat, 90% right there. That's what you have to focus on. If she tells you, when we get married, I will keep Shabbat. Tell her, when you keep Shabbat, call me, we'll go on a date. 1 second. Wait, 1 second. Another minute. Modesty and Shabbat has to be before the first date. Not Rabbi. She's not modest, but she listens to your lecture and she make a progress. I assume in a month or two she become modest. Date her then. People have ups and downs. When she is modest for a few weeks, agree to go on a date. When she keep already Shabbat 2-3 months, agree to go on a date. Before that, don't ever even consider do such thing. Now, I know what you're going to say. My friend dated a girl that she wasn't modest, and today she's a rebbitzin. You're right. Your friend got lucky, and 500 others became goyim because of these girls. So you want to take the risk? It's not going to work. Righteous and wicked, the wicked usually win because he has the help of the Satan to his favor. Also, one more very important thing to consider, it's hashkafa. How do you say hashkafa in English? Views. Kosher views. For instance, conservative, reform, idols worshipping among Judaism. I'll give an example. Some Jews, very orthodox, eat kosher, keep Shabbat strictly, learn Torah, full modesty, very, very strict. They are 100% idol worshipping, worshippers, 100%. They worship the rabbi, whether he's alive, whether he's dead. You gotta be very careful not to go on a date with people like this, even if they keep all the Shulchan Aruch. By only worshipping a man, like the Christians do, don't agree to go on a date with them. It's cult among Judaism. They'll destroy you and your children. Don't agree. All these people from the cults, from my experience, ended up very bad. If you know what's happening now in Israel, the head of the biggest cults in Israel escaped Israel for molesting married women. Always the cults ended up in the worst way, like David Koresh a few years ago, if you know a little bit about cults. People who belong to a cult, no matter how righteous they are, don't agree to date them, men and women. Now, one more thing. After you check modesty, you go on a date with a girl and she tells you, I don't want to cover my hair with a hat or a bandana, whatever you call it. I want to put a wig. So, according to some rabbis, wig it's not good. But some rabbis allow it. Which wigs we are talking about? Modest, up to the shoulders, that's it, not longer than that. Straight, not five different colors, no curls all the way up to the belt. That's not modest wigs, obviously. It attracts more attention, not less. But modest wigs, some holy rabbis allow it. Everything in the world that has an argument between the chief rabbis of Israel, that means holy people are allowing it. It's not a reason to cancel a shidduch for it. Which means, maybe after a year or two, she will agree to become more modest. I know a woman, the only way to turn her religious was to allow her to buy a wig. And that's when she agreed to cover her head. And today, she doesn't have even a wig. Nothing. No, not in weddings, not anywhere. Always covered her hair. If that day they didn't agree that she put a wig, until today she'll be like a goya. So what do you see? It's a one very major step forward. So if the girl said to you, I'm only going to marry, I'm going to be modest. If she doesn't want to be any modest, you don't date her. You don't date her because you know already when they show you who the girl is, she's not modest. I cannot date her. But if she's modest, but she's single, so she's not covering her hair, but she say, after I get married, I will only cover with a wig, even if he's Sfaradi. And even if the chief rabbi of the Sfaradim is against it very, very big, there was another chief Sfaradi rabbi, Rabbi Zion Abba Shaul, who allowed it. So, you know, like two big giants, one yes, one no, no problem. At least not to ruin a shidduch for it. Why? It's very difficult to find modest girls in the world today. It's not that there are millions are waiting online. And you say, well, you show me 50 with wig and show me 50 without a wig, why should I go with the wig? I have 50 other options. That's not the situation. You don't lose a diamond just because there's a little stain on it. It's still a diamond. You have to be clever. That's why many of the guys lost their shidduch because they were foolish. They were so strict on the first date, the girl got scared from them. Oh, it's fanatic, it's crazy. So what's the solution? You have to consult with your rabbi. Someone you trust that he has a healthy head. Not just knows a lot of Gemara and Halacha. Healthy head. He knows about life, he knows people, he knows psychology of the people. And you ask his opinion what to do, how to do, to don a date, to continue, not to continue. And it will lead you to the right direction. I had a girl from a very religious neighborhood. The day of her wedding called me. And by the conversation that I had with her, I realized it's not her shidduch, the one she's going to marry tonight. What am I telling her? 8 hours before the wedding, don't show up to your wedding? I say to her, why did you remember to ask these questions 8 hours before your wedding? Where were you all these 3 months since you met the guy? Don't let it happen to you. Never agree to get engaged if you still have a doubt about the person. The stipler, chief rabbi of the last generation in Bnei Brak, the father of Rav Chaim Kanievsky, he said, if there is a doubt, you don't get married. You don't marry a doubt. This doubt can turn into a nightmare. You don't marry. You stay single another year or two. It's hard, but it's much harder to be married with the wrong person. You have to be very careful. There's a doubt. Doubt in the attraction. 3 dates and you're still not sure if you're attracted to the person. Thank you, goodbye. There's a doubt about his personality. Every little thing he gets angry. Your wishful thinking and hope is that he's going to get out of it. Most likely he won't. It's very hard to change personality. What can we do? Most people don't change. They only get worse with the years. Also, you have to make sure that the person is not too pedantic. Is that the right word? No? Did I just make up a word? In Hebrew, it's pedantic means he pay attention to every little detail. Why there is a little dot on the floor? why something is cheap here, why there's this, why you're wearing this, why this, every little thing bothers him. Why the sleepers are not in a closet, why the kids are not asleep when I come from work. You gotta be very careful. He's gonna drink your blood with a straw, this guy.
You have to
No, you have to investigate about him, how he is. You know, one time I went, I had an opportunity to make the champion of United States in karate. I made him a Baal Tshuva. He went to the Olympic Games to represent America. One time he invited me to his apartment. So I went to his apartment. As soon as I went into his apartment, I realized this guy is sick. Why? I saw two sleepers in the sides of the living room standing parallel in the right angle. Not one like this, one like this. Mamash two. I saw towel, everything in the right order, the table, this, that. Everything is like... So I said to myself, let's see what's going to happen when I move things around. I kicked one of the sleepers. I saw he came and fixed it. I said, okay, now I know he's mentally sick. Then I told him, why he cares so much if the sleeper is like this? So I was in Japan. That's where I learned my karate. In Japan, everything has to be by the book. If a worker messed up in a product in Japan, he commits suicide. He disappointed his boss. You know that? It's unbelievable. There's women who are serving the men, guys, and there's a lot of interesting things in their culture that you don't know where it comes from. They have their culture. He saw influence. I went to his bedroom. I saw all the swords. I said, but, believe it or not, today Baruch Hashem is cured. The Torah cured him. Or maybe his wife cured him after he got married. I don't know. Okay, now questions. Yes. Yeah, you remember the question? Yeah. Okay, so good. I spoke about the girls. Now it's time before we finish. What is the must be by the guy before you agree to date him? So obviously Shabbat, because Mechalel Shabbat is 100% like a goy in the eyes of Hashem. It's in the Shulchan Aruch. And of course, I did not write the Torah. The Torah says, Mechalel Shabbat, areu kegoy lechol davar. It's 100% like a non-Jew. Because Judaism is not who your mother is. Is if you are in the club and following the rules and the guideline of this club or not. If you follow it, you have a membership on this club. If you break the regulations, you lose your status. If you don't keep Shabbat, it's the foundation of Judaism. You are Chris, Christine, Mustafa, Ahmed. You're one of them. Not that they're bad people. Some of them can be a million times better than you personality-wise, generosity, faith in God, etc. But you are not belong to the Jewish nation until you start keeping Shabbat. So you don't want to marry a guy that has a status like this. Obviously, there's no future for you, for your children, or anything like that. But there is something that is just as important as Shabbat. What is it? That he learns Torah every day. If he's a guy that keep Shabbat, eat kosher, have a yarmulke and tzitzit, but don't learn Torah every day, don't agree to marry him, don't agree to date him, especially in these days. Why? Because the only thing that can save the guys from the women on the street, from the Facebook, from what's happening in all kinds of bad places, from the gambling, from the drugs, from bad habits, from personality issues, from addictions, etc. The only way to save a guy today in this world is the Torah. If you're connected to the Torah, there is a chance to become a human being. If not, there is no chance to be a human being. You look like a human being, but you're not. I promise you, take my word for it. I did not find one guy that is not connected to Torah that able to handle his challenges in life in a right way. And there's not, it doesn't exist. So you have to find a person that the minimum of the minimum learns an hour Torah every day. If not, You're taking a huge risk. Huge. Now, if the guy say to you, okay, you're right, I wasn't persistent, I don't learn, but I'm going to start learning. You say, okay, call me in 2 months and we'll see. And you check. You check. If he was serious for 2 months, he started to learn serious. Yeah, why not? Give a chance. It's Baal Tshuva. He fix. If not, don't agree to marry him. He's a businessman. He does. He goes to shul. He does chesed. He donates money. He has great emunah. Beautiful. He doesn't learn Torah. He will never, ever do what Hashem expects him to do. Why? The Torah is the antibiotic against the evil inclination. Who said it? Hashem, not me. Hashem said, Barati Yetzirara. By the women, it's different. By the men, I'm talking men. Barati Yetzirara, I created the evil inclination. And the only way to kill this evil inclination is Torah. No other way. No psychologist, no psychiatrist, no yoga, none of this nonsense. Hashem, the creator of the world that made this desire and Yetzirara, what did he say? I created it, it's killing you, it's destroying you, there's a cure. Torah. Barati Yetzirara, Barati Torah Tavlin. The Torah is the cure, the medicine. And see, you don't believe me? Take any guy from any yeshiva and take a guy from the business district and compare between them. Take one and one. 20 years old, 20 years old. 30 years old, 30 years old. Compare their values. Compare their manners. Compare their emunah. Compare the way they dress. Compare how they watch their eyes. Compare how they talk to their wives. Compare what time they're getting up in the morning. Compare how they keep Shabbat. 50% or 100%? Nothing, you're going to find that the other guy win over the guy who learns Torah. In nothing. The guy who learns Torah always will be better. If you don't believe me, go to a synagogue when the people that pray there don't learn Torah. They're religious, but they don't learn Torah. And go to any yeshiva here in Queens, Sfaradi, Ashkenaz, whatever. And take your binoculars and sit and watch how long they pray, how they pray, how much they talk in the middle of the prayer, how they behave, how they walk, how they talk to the rabbi when they have a question. It's different worlds. It's nothing to compare. You want to be a queen or you want to be a slave? What do you want to be? If you're still not convinced, I have a lecture about it, about Am Haaretz, about an ignorant man. I think it's enough to know that the Torah said that someone who marries his daughter to an ignorant man, which means he's fully religious, but he's just not learning Torah. He doesn't know Torah. It's like tying her to a tree in front of a hungry lion. That's what the Torah says. Now you want to be in this position, tied to a tree in front of a hungry lion? It's your choice. So all the guys here that are saying, why this guy is ruining our chance here? I'm not ruining your chance. I'm saving you from yourself. You don't understand. If you get married without learning Torah, your life will be destroyed, not only her. I'm saving you from your own problems, yourself, not me, the Torah. You see, all the laws in every civilization were made to save the innocent from the criminals. The Torah is the only constitution that is designed to save the criminal from himself. Remember this. Not only for the society, you have to put him in jail that he won't kill us. No. All the punishments of the Torah, it's educational punishment. If a murderer goes to a shelter city, what we call jail today, who goes with him? His rabbi. His rabbi has to go with him to punishment. Why? This is your student and he ended up killing? Go and teach him Torah, make him a human being. You're not dismissed from your obligation. That's what the Torah said. You stole 100, you have to pay 200, not to go to jail. If you stole from me $100,000, what does it help me that you sit 3 years in jail? It's going to give me back my money? No, I want my money back and stay free. What do I care? You don't have? Come work for me for free. That's what the Torah says, slave. You work for me until you pay what you stole. And the many other examples. So men, Shabbat and Torah. It's not so strict with kosher food. It's a shame. It can be improved and easily improved. Not the end of the world. It's not having tzitzit. Don't break a shidduch because of that. He's not praying in minyan. It's not the end of the world. You talk to him slowly, slowly, he's going to go to shul. But he's not keeping Shabbat and he's not learning Torah. Don't agree to date him. He's only keeping Shabbat. Without Torah, don't agree to date him. He learns Torah, not Shabbat, don't agree. He does those two, let's talk. Unless, if he belongs to a cult. The Rebbe never died. The Rebbe makes zivugim. We believe that he's watching us. He's walking with us. We'll die for him. Don't even consider talking to this person. He's an idol worshiper. There's only one God. That's it, not two. Yes? Okay, age, up to 10 years difference between the man and a woman, you don't need to even ask. So if you're 23 and he's 33, it's fine. You're 27, he's 37, fine. More than that, it's better to consult with a rabbi who knows him and you, that can tell you, because some people are maybe older, but they're not so mature like old people. Or sometimes it's the other way around. The woman is very mature. There is not the same. Like if you take a girl, 21 years old, from one nationality, and another girl, 21 years old, from a different nationality, sometimes it's like 10 years difference between them. In their mentality, she cooks, she can raise children, change diaper, do everything, and she only knows how to put makeups, that's it. Even a challah she doesn't know how to make, or an egg. You want to hear my advice? But please don't get offended. Secular people should never get married. It's not good for them. It's a horrible life. Horrible life. 6 months is paradise. 60 years is hell. You don't believe me? Come, I'll show you the statistic. 70% divorce rate. And the other 30% who don't get divorced, why is it, you know? Why? Kids. They're afraid to lose their father's inheritance. She has money. He has money. Where is she going to find someone who gives her money? Huh? What? You want to beat the statistic? Oh, you want to have kids? What for? That they'll be on the street smoking drugs? Huh? Do you know, I want to tell you something. 15 years ago, 14, 15 years ago, I decided to start giving lectures in English. I said to myself, you know, my English, my accent, I only spoke in Hebrew for years. But after September 11, it became even harder because there's really lots of the Israelis who used to be here coming, massive amount of traffic, they don't come anymore. Life became very expensive, security very tight, this, visa. So I said to myself, maybe I'm going to be out of business soon. Not going to be able to give lectures. So maybe I start give lectures in English. So the people told me, you're dreaming. You're not for Americans. They're not going to be able to hear you 5 minutes. You're so strict, this, that. They are, you know, they're used to very soft lectures. They're not Israelis. Forget about it. You come, you punch them in the face, they come kiss your head, and they bite Philin. It's not like this. I say to myself, it cannot be. The Torah doesn't speak only to this group. A soul is a soul. So I started to speak. Who did I start with, Baruch Hashem? With the Bukharians. Very aggressive. So I used to come to 108th Street. Hundreds of guys were on the street like bums. 1 o'clock at night, smoking, talking, this. You know what used to be here. Oh, today almost all these guys are in yeshivot, all of them shomrei mitzvot. One by one, you go to the kollel, to the synagogue. Look how many synagogues opened in the last 15 years. And they're all full, Baruch Hashem. So the idea is like this. You want to be able to get married. You want to have kids. Do it the right way. You don't want to do it the right way. Just don't do it. Don't do it. You want to open a business. You're going to come and open it at 9 o'clock in the morning every day. You're going to give good service. You're going to do the way it should be according to the book. Open. No, don't open. Why getting yourself aggravation? You want to get married? There is only one way according to the rules of the boss. There's only one boss. He made marriage. He made a man, he made a woman. He told us how to get married, what to do, what not to do. You don't want to listen to him? Don't get married. Don't. By the way, to have kids, you don't need to get married. The goyim don't need to. They get married. They just go together. The monkeys in a safari, they have babies without a kiddushin. You know? If you have a girl and a boy without getting married, you made mitzvah pro-urvu. Now you're going to tell me, wait a minute, it's a sin to go with a girl without marriage. Right. But it's a much bigger sin to torture a woman 60 years every day. One way or the other, it's a sin. But this is a much bigger sin. Also, you know that some rabbis in Israel, when they marry secular people, they don't really marry them, and they don't tell them. They don't marry them. They take a witness that is not Shomer Shabbat, and not Shomer Shabbat is like a goy, and a goy cannot be a witness in any Jewish ceremony. And they make the two Jews that are not keeping Shabbat signing the ketubah, and this couple is not married. Why are they doing it? Because they know she's going to cheat on him in 6 months. They see how she dresses. They know what Facebook, internet are. They see how she is. They see this woman. It's, I don't want to say what. So they know it's just a matter of time. In 6 months she's going to cheat. In 1 year she's going to cheat. In 5 years she's going to cheat. She's going to cheat. Why make them married? Better not to. Because when she cheats, it breaks the marriage. Did you know that? If a woman went with another man, her husband not allowed to be with her ever again. If a husband cheat, it's a different story, because according to the Torah, he could have legally married more than one woman. Now let me ask you a question. Why the Torah is allowing a man to marry one, two, three girls, and a woman only one man? The answer is, if a woman would have two husbands, you'll never know who the children belongs to. And it's critical. If one of them Kohen, the other one is not, you won't know if this boy is Kohen or not. You don't know who he belongs to. Today you have DNA. Torah was given, there's no DNA. How are you going to know if she's pregnant from her first husband or the second? There's no way to know. Plus, the mentality of a woman is different than a man. When Hashem created the woman, He made a seal in her body to know if she's a used product or a brand new product in the time of the wedding. Why? Because it's important. By the man, there's no seal. It's also important, but it's not critical. By the woman, it's critical. Do you know that the value of a virgin woman is double than a non-virgin woman according to the Torah? Paying the father, you have to pay double. If she was divorced or a widow, the Torah doesn't even speak about prostitution, because it's obvious. The Torah just says widow or a divorced woman. She's already worth half, spiritually. We're not selling slaves here. So right away you see, by the woman is critical. And you know why? Because the nature of the woman is, the first man she's with him, she's having a long, long, long connection to this man. Even if she gets married to somebody else, she has a connection to the first one. That's why Hashem made it this way. It's going a lot deeper. I gotta tell you something. You know, when a man is together with his wife and they bringing a soul to the world tonight, do you know how critical it is what's on their minds in a time when they're together? If they think about something kosher or not kosher. If they think about each other, if they love each other, if they're both happy, if they're willingly doing it, or he's forcing her to do it, it's going to change the fortune of this baby forever. If it's going to be this kind of baby, or that kind of baby, God forbid, it's determined of what was on their mind in a time when they were intimate. Most people don't know it, that's why they have horrible kids. That's why they beat them up when they're 16 and they steal the car and they smoke drugs and they have to get them out of jail every month. Why? The 10 minutes that they were together 16 years ago determined 40 years of suffering with these kids. If people only knew Torah, life would be so much better. I have a lot more to say, but I'm getting old and I'm getting tired. So we'll give you another question or two, and maybe we'll do part two, Bezrat Hashem, next week. We'll see. I just want to tell you one thing before I forget. Baruch Hashem, Rav Neria and I are good friends. I went to Miami a few times. I love this man very much, and I know hundreds or maybe more rabbis. He's one of my favorite. Why? How do I determine? When I see someone who knows a lot of Torah, I'm impressed. But every rabbi knows a lot of Torah, almost. But when I see someone who cares for the community so much and bring always speaker from outside, where it can get better in this field, where I'm going to bring this expert in this, and I'm going to bring this guest from Israel to talk, and what to do, that shows that the person sacrifices his life for the people. There are places they will never let any outside speaker come and speak. It's all about ego, respect, money, politics. How do you know if the place is kosher and blessed and welcome? When the person is doing what Hashem wants him to do. Baruch Hashem, I have the zchut. I'm happy now, we're neighbors now. Before, I want to just remind me, the last time I went to Miami, I was 6-7 hours on the plane. The plane couldn't land. And I got to the shul instead, I was supposed to land at 6. And I got to the lecture at 11:30, 12, what time I got there? 11:30 at night. Still were more than 100 people waiting. From 8 o'clock until 11:30, people were sitting there, almost nobody left. The plane couldn't land. It was a hurricane, something like this. Baruch Hashem now to come speak to his community and the area here. I don't have to travel in planes, security, take my shoes off. I come here. We can do Bezrat Hashem more than once, twice, three times a month. I also travel a lot, so we'll try to do it as much as we can, Bezrat Hashem. And we can continue. You can choose the topic. Every week or two, we're going to do a different topic. This topic has a lot more to say. But next time when we meet, please come with a list of questions. Because today you only ask 5-6 questions. So now is 2 last questions for tonight. No? Who has a good question? That's it? Yeah.
Let's say you have somebody who just became Baal Shubha, but he's progressing very well, but he has a girlfriend for a long time, but he's already connected to emotional.
Yes.
And she's not on the same level.
Yeah.
What do you tell to this person?
Well, then two people get, when they go out together, when they're not, they're secular, and one became religious and the other one still not. So, obviously, there is no future right now for both of them, unless if the other one will become also religious, because not religious and religious is just not going well together. It's impossible to live together. So what do? You tell the girl, let me give you material, CDs, books, seminars, take it, learn it, see if you want to go in my path or not. I'll wait for you. 3 months, 6 months, whatever you need, take your time. It's worth it for him to try because they already have good chemistry together and they love each other. But if after 6 months she doesn't make any progress, that means she's not serious, she's not interested, then it's time to move on. But if she shows progress, it's worth to wait for her, but of course not to make scenes, to make a physical separation, because the way you behave before your wedding determines how your marriage is going to be. So no intimate relationship before you get married and you put the ring on her finger. So if you used to do it before the marriage, you have to take a period of time that you clean, you're fixing, you're making tshuva, and Hashem will forgive you. If you're together until a day before the marriage or a week before, what are you getting married? You were always married. It's all a show. You really have to get married. Getting married means unite together for the first time. So if you make a break and now re-get together, that's a kosher wedding. But if not, there's nothing to talk about. Also, there's sometimes another case like this, that the girl is more religious and the guy is not getting any better. So what's the solution? Try to convince him to go to yeshiva 2-3 weeks. In yeshiva, it's a huge step forward. What can sometimes take a year can take a week in yeshiva. If you don't want to wait that long, tell him, go 1 week to yeshiva for me. When he eats kosher food and he sees all the righteous guys around him and Torah all day, usually 99% of the time from experience, it makes a huge impact on him. And he will return a new person. But sometimes it's not really the right soulmate, which means Just because you have desire for her and she for you and you think you're in love or whatever doesn't mean you're the right soulmate for each other. You met in a scene, and now when one person becomes religious, sometimes it takes him weeks to realize she's not for me or he's not for me. Same thing by the converts. Before they convert, they have beautiful harmony together because it's no marriage. Once they convert, it's two new different people, new souls. They don't connect anymore. It's very interesting. So you need patience. You don't break it right away. Also, when people are married already and they both secular and one became religious, up to 2 years you should wait. Up to 2 years. If she agreed to go to the mikveh at least that, he can even wait longer. But if she refused to go to the mikveh, he cannot be married to her because without intimate relationship, there's no marriage. What's the point here? Up to 2 years, he will suffer. He doesn't have a wife, cannot touch her. Up to 2 years, it's very difficult. Up to 2 years. More than that, the rabbis will tell him, go get divorced, meet a new wife. But if she agreed to go to the mikveh, you can even wait for her longer. Give her books, CDs, one, hopefully, and pray a lot to Hashem, the one thing will change. Why? If she doesn't eat kosher, it's her problem, mainly. It's affecting you, but it's her. You can still eat kosher in the house. She doesn't want. She go out with a friend. She eats not kosher. It's her problem. She'll pay. Everyone pays for what they do. Everyone. No one is escape. She's mechalel Shabbat. You keep Shabbat. You go to the shul. You make yourself kiddush. She's mechalel Shabbat. It's her problem. Yes, it's ruining your life, but for the peace in the family and not to break the family, and sometimes there are children involved, you're willing to sacrifice. So whatever she does, you can live with, except one thing, mikveh, taharat mishpacha. She refused to go to the mikveh, you're not allowed to touch her. Touching her, it's like touching your own mother. It's a bigger sin. You're not allowed. It's a bigger sin in the Torah to be with your wife without mikveh than to be with your own mother. Did you know that? It's a bigger sin. And the souls get cut out of eternity from one time being together when she did not go to the mikveh. That's the problem of all the boyfriend and girlfriend in a Jewish world. The boyfriend and girlfriend. Every time they're together, it's Yisur Karet. Now, I tell you what the problem is. I know what you're thinking right now. You say, okay, listen, I'm only 18. And I'm not planning to get married the next 4 years. So what, I'm not going to have a girl for 4 years? It's not possible. That's how you think. So what am I going to do? I'm going to continue with my girlfriend for 3 more years. And then we'll become really, we'll break apart. And I'm going to tell her, that's it. From now on, no more sins until we get married. Like you just suggested 10 minutes ago. And we go into the marriage in a kosher way. You're right, but you're wrong. I'll tell you why. Some sins you can correct easily. For instance, you didn't put filling. Whatever you lost, you lost. That's it, you lost it. You're not gaining. But one day you begin to put, you regret, you ask Hashem forgiveness, that's it, it's forgotten. From now on, you begin to collect profit. Some sins, even if you make repentance, even if you're perfect now, you became holy, you must receive suffering as a part of the repentance. Without suffering, the repentance is not complete. All the 36 sins, the most severe sins in the Torah, there are 36. It's a huge, it's a whole league, a separate league of sins. There are 365 restrictions in the Torah. 36 of them, it's a whole separate league. What's the difference between the 36 to the 329 sins? The D36, the Torah say, that someone who violated it get cut. God cut his soul out of eternity. It's called V'nichreta ha'nefesh ha'im Yisrael. I'm going to cut the soul out of my nation. And that's the most horrible punishment a person can even think about. There's nothing come near it. No execution, no death, no Auschwitz, no cancer. No nothing, no bankruptcy, no whatever you can think of, doesn't even come 1% near this horrible punishment, which call, I'm cutting that soul out of eternity. It's horrible. So for sex crimes, falling into many of the 36 is sex crimes. Among them, a single Jew with a single Jewish girl. And every time they're together, she's nida, she's impure, because she cannot go to the mikveh, she's not married. So what happened? Every time it's a karet. However, if a person one day wants to make tshuva, repentance, as long as he's alive, he can correct. There was only one problem. The other 329 restrictions, you can correct without suffering. Suffering is not required. The 36th restrictions that the Torah say the soul is cut, the only way to connect back the soul is through suffering. Problems, sicknesses, bankruptcy, money lost, aggravation, depression. There's a whole huge list. That's it. Only Isurim correct the sin. We can read in the Rambam Ilchot Tshuva. He explained how to do Tshuva for Isurei Karet. Isurim. Even Yom Kippur doesn't fix it. Even 50 Yom Kippur in a row doesn't fix it. Even if you become Rabbi Ovadia Yosef, doesn't fix it. Only one thing fix it in the end. You make tshuva, you repent, you regret, you ashamed, you never repeat the sin, Yom Kippur, and suffering. No suffering, no correction. So why being stupid? Why accumulating a list of suffering to your account? It's negative balance. It's growing with interest and penalty every minute. That one day you're going to have to pay it back. Why? Don't accumulate debt. So what do you do? If you know you're going to marry this woman and you cannot live without a sin, marry her right away. Don't live in a sin. And if not, try to do everything you can not to make sins together until you get married. I know it's hard, but that's it. So how are you going to do it? Learn Torah every day. If you learn a lecture like today, every day, you won't touch her. If you won't learn, you're going to touch her three times a day. You're going to make sins. Why? The Yetzer Hara, the evil inclination. You learn Torah, it kills the evil inclination. You want to have a girl that you're going to marry in a year, but she didn't finish school. You have to wait. Don't make sins with her. How are you going to be able not to make sins? Learn lots of Torah every day, and you see that Hashem is helping you. Why? The Torah destroyed the Yetzer Hara. Thank you very much Clarissa? What's the name? Clarissa? That she organized everything? Huh? Sigalit, okay. Yes, Sigalit and Mazal for organizing a beautiful evening. Thank you, Rabbi. Any more announcement before we finish? Thank you very much. Okay, now one more thing, one last announcement. We just made my CD, Torah and Science, in Russian, which means they mute my voice. Not it's, you know, they mute my voice. And they put a professional Russian speaker instead of my voice. Why we did it? Because it's much easier than to read Russian subtitle for 4-hour seminar. Everyone that his parents doesn't speak such good English or Hebrew can have it now in Russian. How do we do it? Rabbi Neria Baruch Hashem helped me to make already two of my CDs, Life After Death and Torah and Science, into Russian. Baruch Hashem, everyone who wants CDs, please come. I have some CDs. We made new collections right now. Anyone who wants to participate in sponsoring translation of CDs to Russian or to any other language, or to duplicate CDs to make other Jews closer to Hashem, you have either Rabbi Neria here or me, you can talk to us. Thank you very much. Good night. Yeah, one more thing. Yeah. Okay, now one more thing. They're collecting tzedakah here for the poor family who had the fire and lost their homes. I'm sure you heard about it. A very big mitzvah. You help others that are in problems, Hashem will save you from these problems. Tomorrow there's a mitzvah of Afrashat Chala, where? Bet Eliyahu Synagogue. What is it? 173rd, right? For the remedy of this family, Refuah Shlema. Thank you very much. Shavua Tov.
The Russian is all three parts of Zoran science?
All three parts, yeah. Good. In the beginning it was one, now it's three. Thank you very much. Thank you.